Good morning, Riverside family. My name is Mike Tetrall, and I take care of the youth and worship here at Riverside, and we are so glad you could join us this morning. As we worship together, I encourage you to sing out loud, to pray out loud, to participate wherever you are, because we are still a family of God, even if we might be physically separated. We would also love to pray for you. After the service, we invite you to click on the live prayer button at the bottom of this feed, where you can be connected immediately with a member of our prayer team. We would love to pray for you and to support you however we can. Also, as you are able, we encourage you to continue in your faithful giving. There's a giving tab here in the live stream, and it will redirect you to the church's website where you can get more information about giving. Now, we'd like you to take a few moments to greet each other in the live chat, especially if you are new. We would love to hear from you because we are so glad you could join us and you truly matter to us. We would also encourage you to stick around for the makeshift fellowship on Zoom, which is taking place after the service concludes. And the link will be in the live chat if Katrina hasn't already put it there. And you can join us there. It's pretty short, just a few minutes. Very low key, very low pressure. It's just another way that we can be connected, again, even while we might be physically separate. So now I encourage you all to make a joyful noise, to raise your voices to God as we worship Him together.
Dreams. Good morning, Riverside family and friends. My name is Mark Kurgis, and I serve on the leadership team of Riverside Covenant Church. Although we have not been face-to-face as a Riverside community in recent weeks, the leadership team, along with Pastor Corey, have continued to meet, work, and pray for the Lord's direction and guidance for Riverside. This morning, I want to take a moment to update you on three conversations that the leadership team is currently engaged in. The first is, when will we be able to regather together for Sunday morning worship? We, like you, are closely monitoring the CDC, along with our national, state, and county guidelines to determine when we can safely regather in person. As you know, the decision to reopen is much more extensive than simply a date on our calendars. We must also consider things such as, will masks be required or will they be optional? How many people can we safely accommodate in our space if a 6-foot social distancing guideline remains? And how will we facilitate and ensure proper cleaning and disinfecting of all areas, both during and following our worship together? These are just a few of the many important things that we are discussing and discerning. Information from our authorities continues to change and evolve daily, and sometimes it seems to be conflicting. As a result, we may find ourselves with differing opinions about the guidelines and protocols that we will put in place as we begin to regather. We are still uncertain about many things, but we are certain about this. Our individual responses to whatever the new guidelines and protocols might be will be a demonstration of our love and our care for one another. As soon as the leadership team determines the guidelines and timeline for regathering, we will communicate that information with you as quickly as possible. And secondly, with the current social distancing and isolation guidelines in place, the leadership team is exploring the best options for our annual meeting, which is typically held in late June prior to the beginning of our new fiscal year, which begins July 1st. Our desire is to hold a congregational meeting as soon as we can, which would allow for the membership to vote on the proposed 2021 budget, as well as the nominees for both the leadership team and pastoral relations committee. This date will be announced as soon as it is determined. And thirdly, completely unrelated to anything COVID, the leadership team is beginning the process of forming a pastoral search committee for a senior pastor. Now, I realize that many of us haven't even had a chance to meet our interim pastor, Corey, or his wife, Gretchen, yet in person. But we do hope that everyone has the opportunity soon once we are allowed to regather as a full Riverside family. On behalf of the leadership team, I would humbly ask you to keep us in your prayers and to be praying over these things which have been shared. We, along with you, desire for the Lord's will to be done in the life and ministries of Riverside Covenant Church. May you be richly blessed this morning.
Good morning, Riverside. My name is Megan Mills, and we are just excited to worship with you this morning. Today, we are going to talk about what it means to be a good neighbor and what it means to love your neighbor. And I think that it seems rather timely because a sermon on how to love your neighbor 6 months ago, I think might look pretty different than what it is now. I'm not sure I know what it means to love my neighbor right now. Is loving my neighbor staying away from them? Or is loving my neighbor overcoming my fear, trusting this Holy Spirit, and knocking on their front door? It's hard to know, and I think it's different in a lot of circumstances. But as we worship this morning, and as we move into a time of worship, I want to share with you Micah chapter 6, starting in verse 6. It says, "What can we bring to the Lord? Should we bring him burnt offerings? Should we bow before God Most High? with offerings of yearling calves? Should we offer him thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Should we sacrifice our firstborns to pay for our sins? No. O people, the Lord has told you what is good, and this is what he requires of you: to do what is right, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. So as we worship this morning, not in our building, I again want to remind you that we are the church, the people of God, not the building that we gather in. And as we continue in this time, it's so important for us to challenge ourselves with what it means to be the church and love the people around us. Let's worship together.
Kings and kingdoms will bow down, and every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who could stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 The sin of the world.
Experience the glory of your goodness. Let Good morning. This morning, as we go to prayer, I want to keep in mind this text from 1 Thessalonians 5, which says, "Always be joyful, pray constantly, in every situation give thanks. This is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus." One of the most important lessons I have learned in my spiritual life was the simple observation that I heard one teacher give, that this text does not demand that we give thanks for all situations, but in all situations. That difference is huge. To recognize that it is not that we are to be grateful for everything that happens to us or around us in life, but that in the midst of those situations, we have hearts that are filled with gratitude to God for all that He does provide for us. And it is in that spirit that I invite us to come to prayer this morning. As we have been doing for the past several weeks, we are going to be praying what is called a bidding prayer. I will be leading and naming different segments and things to pray for. And as names or situations come to mind, we invite you to type the first name of someone that the Spirit leads to your mind in the box, in the chat box to the right. If you are not watching the live stream but are worshiping with us at another time, we invite you to simply say those names quietly out loud as the Spirit leads. Please join me now in prayer. Trusting in God, we pray for those throughout God's world who are suffering from the impact of coronavirus. May the Lord of mercy bring them health and healing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For the physically weak, isolated, and vulnerable people in every country, may the Lord of compassion inspire us to reach out and care for our sisters and brothers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For those who are working tirelessly to care for those who are seriously ill, may the Lord of love give them courage and wisdom in their service of the most vulnerable and the least of these. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For those dedicated to finding vaccines and treatments for this contagion, may the Lord of wisdom grant them all knowledge and understanding. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For those who are grieving the loss of a loved one at this time, may the Lord of hope give them strength and courage to continue in their faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For all those who have died, whether from coronavirus-related illness or otherwise, may the Lord of life raise them up and welcome them into their heavenly home. God, our Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, came into our world to heal us of all divisions and bring us life in abundance. By the power of your Spirit, help us strive together as one family of many nations to help and serve those in greatest need in this crisis. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood, a neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you be? Won't you be? Please, won't you be my neighbor? Hello there. It's good to be with you again. I used to love watching Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood when I was growing up. Have any of you guys seen It's a Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood? I'm not talking about the weather on your cul-de-sac. I'm talking about that movie, It's a Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood. It's about Mr. Rogers. You know, the one that Tom Hanks did recently? Well, a few weeks ago, we decided to invite our neighbors over for a socially distanced outdoor movie. And we projected It's a Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood onto our garage. Everybody brought their own chairs and brought their own snacks. Ironically, It's a Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood got rained out. Before we finished the movie, we had to stop it because the rain came. But it was such a sweet time anyway. We moved into our neighborhood about a year and a half ago. And after hearing loads of horror stories about neighbors, we didn't know what to expect. But we have the most amazing neighbors. One bright spot of this global pandemic for our family has been having the chance to get to know our neighbors better. Do you have any neighbors? What are your neighbors like? It's interesting how our own experiences with neighbors can really color our perception of what it is to love our neighbors. In the days when Jesus walked this earth, there was a lawyer who had a bit of a rough experience with his neighbors that caused him to ask a lot of questions about what it looks like to be a neighbor. Let's read about it together in Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25, says, "On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law? He replied. How do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Let's stop there for a moment. So Jesus is such an amazing teacher. He rarely just gives an answer. Rather, he answers a question with another question, craftily turning it back onto the questioner. Here, an expert in the law, the lawyer, asks a question. And considering that it is the lawyer's area of expertise, Jesus basically asks him to answer his own question. The lawyer answers well, quoting from the Mosaic Law in Deuteronomy about loving God with everything, and in Leviticus about loving your neighbor as yourself. Jesus commends him for his answer and exhorts him to do it. Because knowing and reciting is fine and good, but there is no fruit in knowing what you should do. Doing it, living it out, that's where it happens. Now, the next verse says a lot about the lawyer's heart. Verse 29 says, but he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? First of all, this question indicates that there is some separation between loving God and loving our neighbors, as if he's good on the first task, but needs some clarification on the second. In reality, loving our neighbors is part of loving God. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 20, it says, For we cannot love God, whom we have not seen, if we do not love others, whom we have seen. Who is my neighbor? In the context of the verse in Leviticus chapter 19, which the lawyer quoted, the classification of neighbor is for the Israelite people. Then a few verses later, it's expanded to include the resident foreigners. In verse 34, it says, "The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself. For you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God." This concept of neighbor being limited to fellow Jews and foreigners living among them, this would have been understood among the Jews in that time. However, in the first century, the Jews found themselves in a situation where the foreigners in their land were actually ruling them. So understandably, their view of foreigners residing among them had soured. In that space, their loyalty to their own people intensified, and their desire to include outsiders in their neighborly love dwindled. The question of who is my neighbor was likely a hopeful attempt to shrink the boundaries of neighbor, to eliminate some of the undesirables from the task list. Through the parable he spoke next, Jesus did the very opposite. He abolished any and all boundaries to love of neighbor. Let's read Jesus' response, starting in verse 30. It says, "In reply, Jesus said, 'A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." The road from Jerusalem to Jericho was notoriously dangerous. It spanned about 18 miles and it had a descent of around 3,300 feet. And it was chocked full of great hiding places for robbers. So it was really no surprise that the man was robbed, beaten, and left half dead on this particular road. Then along came a priest, one of the top ranking religious officials, one whom the Jews listening to Jesus' telling of this story would have expected to be the hero. I imagine that the victim would have felt himself very lucky that a priest would happen upon him in that state and been filled with great hope for his survival, hope that would have been short-lived and dashed as the priest passed by on the other side. Then along came a Levite, the second ranking religious figure, whose presence may have raised the victim's hopes again slightly, just to dash them again as he too passed by on the other side. At this point, many of the Jewish listeners may have assumed that the hero of the story would be an ordinary Jewish man, as Jesus had over and over set himself against the religious authorities. It would have been in line with his other teachings. The Jews would have been shocked, even disgusted, to hear that the hero was a Samaritan. If you remember back a couple of months ago, we talked about the great rift between the Jews and the Samaritans. In case you didn't hear or you don't remember, let me remind you. It began about 1,000 years before this,
Around 930 BC, there was great discord among the Israelites, and the nation split into two kingdoms. There was Israel in the north and Judah in the south. Eventually, the northern kingdom of Israel made its capital in Samaria. Then 200 years later, Israel fell to Assyria, and Samaria became their headquarters. Most of the Jews there were exiled, but some farmers and others were left behind. The Jews who remained in Samaria intermarried with the Gentile settlers who were sent to colonize the land. And they held on to some of their Jewish roots, but they also adopted the worship of foreign gods alongside the God of Israel. These people became the Samaritans. After Assyria took Israel, the northern kingdom dissipated in exile, but the southern kingdom of Judah remained for another 200 years until Babylon defeated them and exiled their people. After 70 years of exile, the Babylonians allowed a remnant of 43,000 people to return to their home and rebuild Jerusalem. The conflict between the Samaritans and the Jews grew upon their return. The Samaritans were not in favor of the Jews taking their land to resettle. And the Jews, who were driven by bloodlines and the law, viewed the Samaritans as half-blood mongrels. They were disgusted by them and considered them a disgrace. Interestingly, the Jews had more disdain for the Samaritans, whom they shared some beliefs with, than they did for other Gentiles whom they shared no beliefs with. It was a deeply rooted political and religious feud, and it was a bold statement from Jesus to make a Samaritan the hero of this story. They would be the least likely to fit into their current frame of neighbors. Who is my neighbor? The Samaritan hero blew up that question. Unlike the priest and the Levite, when the Samaritan saw the man in the ditch, he was moved with compassion and he stopped to help him. This is where the genius of Jesus's methods of teaching comes out. Because after he finished the story, he asked the lawyer a question. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? Being the master of reframing, instead of simply answering the lawyer's questions, Jesus totally changed the question. And he did it by shifting the perspective. Commentator John Roland said, "It is from the perspective of the ditch where one lies helpless and battered and in desperate need of help that one should reflect upon the question, who is my neighbor? Then one will know how wide the reach of neighbor love should extend when one is in a position to be handing out favors." Jesus gave the lawyer a new perspective and a new question. From who is my neighbor to how do I be a good neighbor? From who all do I have to love as myself to how do I love others as myself? Sometimes we can spend so much time and effort searching for an answer to the wrong question. Finding the right question can be half the battle. When Jesus asked which of those three was the neighbor, the answer was quite obviously the Samaritan. But the lawyer was so put off by this twist that even though he answered correctly, he could not bring himself to say the word Samaritan, and instead responded with the words, "the one who had mercy on him." Jesus answered, "go and do likewise." Again, he points him to action. What an interesting way to answer the question, "who is my neighbor?" Instead of a list of people or qualifiers, Jesus challenged the lawyer to act as the Samaritan did. He challenged the lawyer to be the neighbor. In his creative story-based answer, Jesus illustrated to the lawyer that neighboring is an art. It's not a science. It's not a checklist of duties for a choice group of people. It's an approach of living toward all people that we cross paths with. There's no formula. There's a posture. In the telling of this story, Jesus not only revealed that there are no boundaries to his neighborhood, he also illustrated the posture of neighboring through the merciful actions of a dreaded Samaritan. Where the priest and the Levite saw the naked man beaten and continued on, the Samaritan stopped. I can think of plenty of what we would all consider valid excuses as to why those two didn't stop, such as fear of the dangers that might come by stopping, not wanting to get tangled up in whatever mess may have caused this man to be in that situation, having an important task on my journey ahead that needs to be completed and not having the time to stop. Or even thinking that someone needs to help that poor man, not thinking for a moment that I could be the person that needs to stop and help that poor man. The Samaritan was open to a detour from his plans. He had a posture of interruptibility. Alexander McLaren said, "The world would be a changed place if every Christian attended to the sorrows that are plain before him." Fred Rogers, you know, Mr. Rogers and his neighborhood, he lived an interruptible life. The people who worked with him were sometimes driven crazy by this posture. He would drop whatever he was doing to give attention to whoever was right in front of him. His desire was for everybody to be his neighbor, and it changed people's lives. How interruptible is your life? When the Samaritan stopped, he was moved with compassion for the man in the ditch. Compassion truly begins with a posture of empathy, the act of thinking about things from someone else's perspective, imagining and engaging with another's experience. Empathy is a challenge for many of us because it requires us to get outside of our own world to see another. It requires a desire to learn about the deeper parts of others that are not part of our own experiences. And it requires an openness to release any perceived thoughts or ideas, or even prejudices, so that we might understand somebody else's reality. In cases of extreme difference, as it was with the Samaritan, empathy humanizes the other. And it shows that all are worthy of our love. What role does empathy play in your life? Empathic concern moves us to compassionate action. For the Samaritan, it compelled him to care for the man in the ditch and meet his needs. He tended to the man's wounds. He gave up his own ride to transport him to more care. He arranged for further care in his absence, showing concern for the man's full restoration. And he paid for all of his needs, including the offer to cover anything above and beyond the 2 denarii that he had given, which was equivalent to 2 days of wages. It's one thing to consider the cost of covering the cost of a family member or friend, but for a complete stranger? The Samaritan had a posture of generosity, expecting nothing in return. His altruistic and sacrificial generosity made this stranger his neighbor. Jesus said that in conjunction with loving him with everything that we are, loving our neighbors as ourselves is the most important way of kingdom living. That's eternal life. So, who's my neighbor? Well, who are you crossing paths with? Take a moment to think about it. Whether it's short interactions or long-standing relationships, he's your neighbor. She's your neighbor. They're your neighbors. Yep, even those who are sitting next to you on the couch right now. The harder question, the question that we need to be asking, is how am I being their neighbor? How am I loving them as myself? What's your posture? Are you interruptible, or are you too busy or distracted to stop? Are you empathic, or are you too focused on your own life to see outside of your world? Are you generous, or does fear or greed cause you to hold back? In the lawyer's question, who is my neighbor? He was asking Jesus to evaluate the frame of neighbors. Tell me who fits in here. Tell me who all that I have to love as myself. And in his creative, story-based answer, it was as if Jesus broke that frame wide open and instead handed him a mirror and asked, how are you being a neighbor? Friends, Jesus' neighborhood has no boundaries, and it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. Please, won't you be a neighbor?
You won't.
we go our separate ways today, I encourage you to look for neighbors to love. On your street, at the grocery store, in your home. The Good Samaritan had a posture of interruptibility, of empathy, and of generosity. In the words of Jesus Christ, go and do likewise. Go in peace. Amen.